I really appreciate the collaborative nature of what we've just been talking about. I think Peter and I and Charles, nice to meet you. So it's good to have a chance to and share some of the things that I've learned and done over the past few years. So here's kind of the outline of what I want to go over. Kind of where we started, I want to cover this term of disruptive innovation and apply it to disruptive education and see if I can't inspire some additional disruptive innovation to occur in all of your minds. I included some slides here on business strategy and some key decisions around that. Kind of want to just get a little bit of sense.
That all of us should think about in terms of education and lessons learned in business. So I did add though, kind of focus, I want to get some of your feedback and thoughts on some education specific discussions and talking points that I'd like your insights on and thoughts on. So let's go for that. Quick introduction or some more details on my background. So I actually grew up in Provo. I went to Timview High School, played basketball there. I actually spent a year at UVU before I went on an LD Uruguay, part-time in Brazil. Earned my bachelor's degree from BYU in elementary education and then moved up to Washington State where I was a sixth grade school teacher for 5 years. And during the summers worked on my master's degree at Central Washington University. I'll come back to Stanford because let me say during that time I got a grant, I guess I'm jumping down here, this is back in the mid-90s, to bring the internet into the classroom, into my sixth grade classroom. It was a Washington State technology grant and I volunteered, and you can imagine a lot of the teachers were, you know, the internet, what's that? And I don't want that in my classroom. And I was like, I'll take it, I'll do it. So it was a fun experience to bring, you know, computers and connected to the world. We built projects that we shared with schools around the world. It was a lot of fun. So that was kind of my step into internet online education. And that led to a job offer at Novell in 99, which is based in Provo. And I'd grown up in Provo, and so it was kind of time for our family to move back and to run Novell's online training program. Because I'd had experience with online education, even it was the middle school, I got the job and had experience with all the different learning management systems and online ed and how to, you know, the right access to mentors and hands-on practice and content and all that stuff I was well aware of. And so I shifted careers and went from teaching the classroom to Novell. And just since we're in the education space, you guys appreciate this. So one of these learning director at-risk youth programs I ran that summer before I started at Novell in August. I just remember this specifically. I was running and I was in a first grade classroom of at-risk youth in Washington, helping them have a summer program. And 2 weeks later, I was at this high-tech company. You know, so that finished like August 2nd, and I started at Novell August 9th. So you imagine those worlds of first grade classroom jumping into corporate boardrooms, and a few weeks later I was invited to present the online training program that I was, you know, proposing to a group of executives in Manhattan, downtown New York City. So, I mean, I was, you know, they all thought I knew what I was talking about, but I was like, do you know, like just a few weeks ago I was working with first graders at risk in this program, you know, it just, I was in these worlds. It was just crazy. But I brought those together and I've just loved it. And so I worked at Novell 13 years. And as part of that time, I ran their education, online education program, as well as then moved on to on-site education and this was training Novell customers, their techies at Novell customers on Novell software. So I didn't deliver the training. I just ran the program and we brought in all the experts to deliver it. after that, Novell sent me to a Stanford executive management program, said, Matt, we'd like you to get kind of the executive management business side of your education. So I enjoyed that, came back and moved into a new business role at Novell. And that's where I was the marketing director. And that's where I really got into the business side of things and have done a bunch of different startups. And, you know, Peter referenced one story for another day. But selling an early startup to Trump in the Trump Tower, went to New York and all that stuff. It was a lot of fun. But I've been the chair and board member of lots of different entrepreneurial organizations as well as education institutions. And I've done tons of research around public school choice and different disruptive models that you can do to help education improve and increase and better serve the needs of kids. And just on that note, my master's degree was kind of focused on public school choice. And from the early beginnings of my tech high, we had to make that decision. Do I want this to be a private tuition-based school program where those that can afford it can take it? Or can I figure out a way to do a public school model like a public school of choice so that it's tuition-free and any kid can join and not have the threshold be private tuition? So anyway, I just shared that. I think that was an important part of our decision. And we made it public school program tuition free. So that's what I wanted it. So this is our vision that we set out from the beginning. And what I'm pleased with is almost 7 years later now, we haven't changed this. And so most businesses go through a lot of different iterations of their vision. I'm pleased to report that this is what we built the first year. And it is so defining of what we want and what we believe in that it has stuck, and I'm really happy with that. The first one is kind of around this patriotism feeling that I love America, and I don't think we teach innovation and entrepreneurship enough to kids. We ignore those two principles, and yet I believe that was what our country was founded on. And so that's really what I want to instill in children, the idea of innovation and entrepreneurship, and we can do stuff like that. Secondly, really powerfully, is that every child is unique. And no matter how many battles I have with the state where they say every child is standardized and you just need to treat them as one certain block of clay, it's not true. Every single child is different. And so I truly believe in personalized education and that it is possible to achieve that and within a public school system. And so we've been able to do that. I'm real pleased with that. And you have to work closely with parents in order to design personalized education programs. And that's a key part of our element. And then third, I thought, you know what? What do we want this to be focused on? Do we want it to be focused on sports, fine arts, music, you know, whatever? And it could have been my dance high or something, right? But we said, you know what? What's going to be, in my mind, the most successful foundation we can give? It's technology. So we built My Tech High. And that was the belief that if we can instill in children a confidence and capabilities in technology, they'll be successful in whatever career path or college path they pursue. So in college, career, and life, if you have a strong foundation in technology, I'm confident we've given you the best skills we can to be successful. So anyway, I'm excited about that, and that's what I believe in passionately and what we try to do every day. All right, let's jump into the disruptive innovation model. So anyone know these two gentlemen?
Clayton Christensen.
Guy on the right, Clayton Christensen, the world leader in disruptive innovation. Anyone know? I heard that right there. Any other? Eric Schmidt. Who's Eric Schmidt?
Google.
The CEO of Google, right? And I was at Novell when Eric Schmidt announced, I'm going to leave, this was in 2000, I'm leaving for a small startup in Silicon Valley called Google to be their business guy. Because they, you know, they had the intelligent, bright startups from Stanford. I'm going to go be their business guy to see if we can't take this company to a multi-billion-dollar company. And all of us, we were thinking, oh, take us with you, Eric, right? Because it sounded so cool back then. And you can obviously see what Google did. So really, brilliant gentlemen. So I've been in rooms with both these individuals. And in one meeting, I heard Eric Schmidt say, and this was just a few years ago when he presented at the Utah Technology Council here in Salt Lake, he said, I've started to see some innovation occur in higher ed, but I have yet to see any innovation, any significant innovation occur in K-12. And I kind of said, you know what? I think I'm onto something. I think I can address what he just said isn't happening. And we have. And so that's kind of cool. And Clayton and I was in an innovation seminar with him just to understand his model. I said, you know what? I'm going to try to apply step-by-step Christensen innovation model to K-12 and see if I can't make it happen. And so I literally just kind of mapped it. And I, last summer, was so happy with my map after so many years, because all these things were happening that he predicts in innovation cycles, that I sent a note to his guy, Michael Horn, who's in charge of Clayton Christensen's Disruptive Education Division of Clayton Christensen Institute. And so I just had to. I said, hey, Michael, you've got to know that I've applied your disruptive innovation cycle to disruptive education for K-12. What do you think? And this is what he replied. And I was like, oh, that's cool. You know, because he is internationally known for seeing and evaluating disruptive education ideas. And he was very intrigued, extraordinarily interesting. So anyway, I took that kind of as a validation. I've applied well the disruptive innovation cycle to K-12 education. I bring this up too because lots of people have been trying over the years to make an impact on K-12. So these individuals, anyone know this? Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook founder. He donated $100 million to the New Jersey school district, trying to say, hey, can money solve some problems? Now, we won't go into the debate of results, but I just want to show that people are trying. He gave $100 million. We're all well familiar with Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, hundreds of millions of dollars over the years, helping to define some change in education that can be long-lasting and measurable and impactful. Oprah, same thing, both nationally and internationally, builds schools, helps donate to young kids' education. But this one over here, anyone know his name? George Lucas.
After episode one, he's dead to me.
So he sold out, no, he sold to Disney, and Bill Gates invited a group of people to donate half their wealth to a cause, right? George Lucas donated the dollar amount, which I'll say in just a moment, to start Edutopia. This was just a few years ago, to further the innovation cycle of education. Anyone know how much George Lucas donated? You could Google, I Googled it the other day just to verify. $4 billion to Edutopia to disrupt or improve education for K-12. Now, yeah, I don't really know exactly where all that's being spent or how that's doing, but that's not the point today. People are trying to do something because our education system needs some reform. And so I just wanted to say we're all in this, in trying to help make a better life for the young people who are coming behind us. Now, this was an article from Sunday, March 8, 2015. The governor of California announced $50 million bounty for anyone that can come up with college innovation ideas. So now you guys are all in higher ed, which I am not touching yet. But to disrupt higher ed, a very democratic, very liberal-leaning governor says, you know what, it's broken. And normally this is someone who's a staunch supporter of public ed and traditional settings. He says, we need innovation to occur in higher ed. Here's $50 million. The article said, I think 51 companies have put in their bids to be evaluated, and they're going to announce sometime this summer of what the most innovative, disruptive idea for higher ed is. Can't wait. I'm curious to see who's going to get that and what's it mean. Okay, the next few are around business, more principles, so let me just go lightly over them. But these are a couple of concepts I followed the lean startup. It's basically where you try to build things quickly that a customer will pay for and then iterate quickly and not do the traditional thing. And this kind of applies to course development and in the model of, we sometimes say, let's get our specs of what a course should have, let's go into a closet and build it, and then come out and launch the course. So same kind of thing in business. A lot of people will take a product idea, they'll go build it in a closet after 6 months or a year and come out and launch it and use, you know, marketing spend to get people to buy it. Opposite of that is the lean startup, where you build a little bit and see if anyone likes it. And will anyone pay for that? And if they pay for it, you build a little bit more and you iterate quickly. And by the time the year's over, you've built something that a lot of people are already paying for instead of just, does that make sense, the difference? Anyway, so I think that's a pretty cool thing around continuous innovation is needed, not just innovate once and let it go stale. Okay, let me share also just quickly some of the key decision trees we made early on about MyTechHigh. The first decision was for profit or not for profit or nonprofit. That's a typical decision point that a lot of any business entrepreneur needs to make. And so I was watching a documentary on Walmart, and it was talking about the executives from Walmart meeting 6 days a week, and especially all day Saturdays, to review that week's sales numbers. And they lived in a state of paranoia that Target was going to take over. And these, you know, they make $1 billion a day. Walmart does, you know, like $200 or $300 billion a year. How are they paranoid every Saturday morning on their business? But that's what they are. And so I was like, oh, I'm not doing a for profit. That's just, I don't want to do that. So I said, I'm going to launch a nonprofit. And so I got into the nonprofit world and talked to business leaders, and turns out they're all paranoid that the Walmarts of the world aren't going to give them more money, because they're all funded by for-profit companies or government grants, which are, government grants are paid for by taxes from companies, right? So it's like this dichotomy I couldn't quite figure out, because they were just as paranoid as the for-profit ones. And so I thought, well, I'm going to have to do something in the middle, because I want to make sure I'm doing good in the world. And so we kind of, you know, and Warner Woodworth, I don't know if you, he's a good friend of mine, he's always talked to me about social entrepreneurship. So I said, you know what, that's what I'm going to call myself. So it's a for-profit, but I believe we're doing good in the world, and so I feel like it's got a good social cause that I want to do the rest of my life. So anyway, those are just some things I wanted to share as you go through your cycle of, if you're going to launch a business or pursue business models, you know, think about that decision point. Another key one. Anyone know Josh Coates, what he founded? Anyone? I know BYU doesn't use it, but most schools, Canvas. Have you heard of Canvas?
Yeah.
So, oh, you guys do use it. Oh. Strike that. Like I said, you guys don't use Canvas. So Josh Coates, I was in a similar setting like this, and he said, any business startup, you need to decide right from the start, are you going to be a bootstrap lifestyle company or a venture-backed scale and sell? Don't judge the value of either one. They both have merits, but just don't try to mix the two.
Can you explain what that means?
You bet.
I don't know what a bootstrap lifestyle is.
You bet. So a bootstrap lifestyle company is one where you use your own funds and resources, your own dollars, to invest the capital needed to start the company. You own it, you run it, you are in charge of it. And typically you want to build it in a way that it doesn't kill your life, because you want to make good profit with a good lifestyle balance and longevity, and I'm going to do this for the rest of my life. A VC stands for venture capital, where you then build a business model and you go try to raise $1 million to start your business with the intent that you're going to kind of burn it hard for 3 to 5, 7 years and scale it so fast that someone will buy the company from you. And all the venture capitalists and you are rewarded handsomely. So Josh Coates, for example, in, I think he was in 2.5 years, took Mosey from a startup to selling it for $70 million to EMC. So that's, you know, and 2.5 is fast, right? So it was after his exit and sellout to EMC that he started in structure. That makes sense? So that's the difference. So it's very different way to do things if you're going to go VC scale and sell. You're not profitable. You're just spending VC money for many years until you sell it and everyone's happy then.
Okay.
So I hope that helps. We decided to make MyTech High a bootstrap lifestyle company. So again, once you make that decision, it informs many things that you do. And so I would just a little plug on that. As you go down that path, don't feel bad about one or the other. Just don't, you can't mix them. Because if you start your own little lifestyle and you know, you're friends and family, you're doing it and you're enjoying it, and you think that it should be ripe for investment and a scale and sell, it just looks differently than how to do it right from the start of a VC-backed startup. So anyway, hope that helps with that. And this is just a quick story that I love to tell. It all comes down to why are you doing it? And so this is my story of the fisherman and the MBA. So this MBA, we'll call it a guy or a girl, I'll just use he for the story. MBA takes his annual trip to Bahamas for his Christmas break. And he's sitting on the beach, and every day about 1 o'clock, he sees this fisherman who's been lounging around on the beach all morning, get up about one in the afternoon, get in his boat, go out and fish for a couple hours, come back with a big load of fish that he gives to his family, and they have dinner for the night. And he goes back and chills on the beach the rest of the evening. The MBA goes up to, after the whole week of seeing this every day, he goes, hey, man, if I gave you $100,000, you could buy a second boat, you could hire a whole crew, you could triple the number of fish you're collecting, you could then sell your fish on the open market, you could package tuna in cans and be global provider of supplier of fish. And the fisherman says, well, why? Why would I do that? And the MBA says, and here's the punchline, so that you can retire to a beach and just lounge around all day and only have to fish, whenever you want. The guy said, I already do that. Right, so no thanks. So anyway, I think that story has helped me forever understand why are you pursuing something. So anyway, that's helped us decide we wanted to make a lifestyle business that we could do. I basically said, what do I want to do when I'm 70 or 80 in my, day-to-day activities? And it was help kids be tech entrepreneurs. So I said, well, if that's what I want to do then, why don't I figure out a way to do it now and do it all that time too? And so anyway, it's been a fun ride. Let me just share a few things that, and I think this applies well to any educational practice as well. The key to deciding what to do is actually not what to do. It's what not to do. And this probably could apply well to, a scope, a project scope for building a course or whatever. You have to decide what not to include. Because you can always include more. And you can always do more. There's always stuff to do. The key decisions are what you're not going to do. So I hope that helps, because that's really what I believe. And it's to avoid the growth drug. Because people come to me all the time. Hey, Matt, have you ever thought about? Whenever you hear that, it's just a bunch of stuff about to come. Have you ever thought about doing this and 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 this? Oh, yeah, I've thought about all those things, but I'm good. Right? So you have to kind of decide where you're going to be in your pursuits. So we identified three business pursuits of MyTech High. And these are the three. Manage a full-time program of personalized education through public schools. That was one business pursuit. Business pursuit number two, sell these standalone tech courses to private pay parents around the world who are interested. Oh, is that me? I'm echoing. And number three, license these tech courses to schools. Right? So those are three legitimate business paths. Now moving this fall into our seventh year, we're still just on number one. And again, people are always saying, hey, do do two and three. You should have already done that. You should have. Well, you know what? One's been great, and we've been doing a great job, and it's enjoyable. So we're just starting this summer to dabble in pursuits two and three. Well, let me just explain, because Peter said, yeah, I want to understand this business model that MyTechHi is. And this is it. The schools that we partner with receive the full funding from the state for every student who's enrolled in that school. They then hire, and Provo School District, for example, is one of the most innovative districts in our state. They've hired a bunch of different program providers to offer as many choices to parents as possible. They believe in choice, and I love it. I'm very impressed with it. So we're just one of the options of Provo eSchool. They also have a BYU Independent Study Program. They have another program from K-12, the largest online provider in the world. And so we're just one program that's available, and they pay us to manage this personalized program for them, a portion of the money they receive for each student from the state. Yeah?
Do you manage the full program for each child or a portion of the program?
A full program.
And are both of those options, or does that have to be a full program?
Meaning?
So if the child wanted to take some from BYU Independent Study, some from K-12, some from you, could they say, well, I like this course over here from MyTechHi, I like this from K-12, and I like this from BYU Independent Study. Do they have those options?
Yes. Okay. So our model is a menu of core classes to choose from.
A la carte.
A la carte, yep. So we have lots to do in K-12, lots to do in BYU Independent Study, Edgenuity, Apex, Alex Math, I mean all the different options. Because basically, just on that note, at the start we thought, okay, we're going to have the best core ever. So I was on the task to find the best core. So I met with all of these providers, and they all said, our history course is the best. Well, it looks very similar to all these other ones I've looked at. And they all said their core was the best, and I didn't know how to choose the best one. So I turned to parents and said, which one's the best one? And they all said, well, Johnny likes that one, Susie likes that one, and just on down the road, I'm like, well, which one should I pick? And they're like, well, can't you figure out a way to have us choose for ourselves which one's best for our child? Yes. And it was so, and we're really the only, I think the only program in the world that believes that type of choice is good. So many say, you've got to pick one and manage all of that and choose that's the best way. Don't leave it up to individual choice like that. And I love how we're doing it. So it's been a really cool thing. And parents really love it as well, having the ability to choose which one's best for their child. And it's been remarkable. So this is what I'm really excited about. So over the, yeah.
Can I just ask a question about that? What criteria do you give them, or what categories do you give them to make their choices based on? Because I remember we were in a situation a while ago with one of our daughters where we had to, she couldn't take a required class in the school mm-hmm. and also take, you know, the choir class that yep. she really wanted to take. And so she
so you're on the SEOP route of online provider.
Yeah, and so we went there, and there was a huge number of choices. Mm-hmm. You could go in and look at each of them, but there wasn't a really manageable way to even figure out what the quality was. And when we, yep. you know, I contacted one of the places, I won't say which one, but I kept getting, they didn't answer my question, and then for the next year, I got spam from mm-hmm. them, you know, mm-hmm. saying sign up for this and that yep. and this and that. So
I don't have an easy answer, so I will be direct about that. It's not easy to build something to inform a parent what's best for them. And so we've tried from the beginning. How do we do that? So the best we can do is give them demo access and accounts. But what we have found most effective is for them to network with their fellow parents and say, what has worked well for you? And we've seen that kind of collaborative sharing occur amongst parents. that is probably the most, you know, my kids like this and this and this. Oh, that reminds me of our third was like this and this and this, and they really liked Alex, or they really liked that. So it's really, that's been, you know, it's not scientific, but it is, that's what I've found to be the best, is we kind of hook them up with other parents to have that chat, and we give them demo access, and we will make changes in September. So you can usually tell a kid's engagement after a couple weeks. So they're like, this is not working. So we say, let's try something else. And we put them in a different program. So that's, so it's trial and error, I guess, and collaborative with other parents. And that's the best I have found to do. But if we can come up with something else, I'm sure our parents would appreciate that. But that's what we do. So this is our catalog of tech courses. And again, no one else offers this kind of list to kids. And these are designed for the 10 to 14 year old kid. I mean, that's our average age target audience. The high schoolers just go through it faster. The younger ones take longer. But it's still, when you're teaching some of these concepts, it doesn't really matter your age. You just need to give them the time to work through that. And some can go faster and some go through it slower, and that's great. So, I mean, look, just Intro to Minecraft. That's one of our most popular ones. You can imagine teaching them Java programming on how to build stuff into their Minecraft world. It's awesome. Python, C++, then robotics. We're talking about NXT, and we use Intro to Robotics uses Lego WeDo for the six-year-old. Then we've got, you know, animation, cartooning, game design, Google Ninja, art, digital photography, and then we also want, you know, so everyone has to take in our program a tech or business class. So if they are totally opposed to that, they need to choose another program, because we believe everyone needs at least exposure to a tech or business experience. And so we have kids as young as six taking our Intro to Entrepreneurship class. And, you know, it's just basic stuff. But we had a 10-year-old selling soap online that she made from her farm in Logan that had goat's milk that was popular for soap. And she was charging $5 a bar for people who had sensitive skin. She was 10 or 11. She had pictures of her goats on her website that she had nurtured from birth. And, you know, people were loyal customers because of her story. And anyway, I thought it was awesome. Anyway, you had a question?
I was going to ask, you said, you know, if they didn't take longer, they can take longer. Are they on a model where they have to finish in a certain amount of time? How flexible is
Time? Because of the full-time public school program, we run from September to May. Mm-hmm. So they have that full year to finish. And the high schoolers, if they finish early, can swap out in semester, in January. But most like to just take their time, because again, this is kind of the point we want to get to, is how do you develop courses that then allow freedom and creativity to occur? And we get to a point where we might have taught them the concepts in a month, but spend the next 3 months building as many games as you can, and just you practice all that, or, you know, and you can on all different genres of games, or, you know, just what else can you build to extend your lifetime of that knowledge. So I like that. Best marketing strategy ever. If you're into the business side and want to just market, this is the, of all the years I've studied marketing, this is the one sentence that I would say is the best marketing strategy. Be irresistible to a small group of passionate sneezers. If you need an explanation, it's a little bit vague or abstract. Find an audience that you have something that is irresistible to them. Instill in them passion about your solution and encourage them to sneeze. And by sneeze means spray to their friends and family what they know about your product. If you can do that, it's remarkable. That is the holy grail of marketing, is to find a passionate group of customers who find you irresistible, and they're so passionate they sneeze to everybody. And that spreads the love. So, has it worked? First year we did traditional marketing. 92 kids we started with. Every year we just want it, we listen to parents that tell us what you need. Tell us how we can help this school be school program work for your child. They sneezed and sneezed and sneezed and sneezed, and now we're almost on track. We'll have about 1,700 kids this fall in a Utah-only, lowest per pupil spending in the entire country, and we're having a successful model with kids who love it and parents who are telling their friends and family about it. It's really remarkable. Oh, so I wanted to share this. I wonder if it goes up. Oh, let me go to... So we had a showcase night, and you just have to see. This is our highlights of our kids. Is it loud enough?
On the right panel, yeah. There you go.
There's our Minecraft girl. Our rocketry course is pretty popular as well. That's a cool, oops.
So I'm actually on the eSchool website right now. How do you find your courses? I'm having trouble finding them.
Through mytechhigh.com.
So, but they will count as eSchool even though they don't show up there?
That's correct. Yep, that's, they have a program and we run a program under their school as well.
Matt, can you explain a little bit? I'm a little confused on the model of like if it's a fully online program, or I guess like are students taking all these classes online, or
so. Yes, it's all an online program, but some of the models might be they buy books to read, and so it's you know, again, it's personalized to every individual child.
But they don't meet. They're not meeting.
It's all face-to-face. It's all virtual in that sense. Yes.
And do they do it for all of their schools?
Yes. Okay. Yep. It is their full-time experience. Yep. And it's grades K-12. Now what? Maybe just to add to the answer, many of these families get together face-to-face during the week all the time. Many of them co-op together to rent different rooms or go to the libraries or meet regularly for Shakespeare days or book clubs or debates. Or it's amazing what's happening out there in the online world on the physical side of families getting together. It's really quite remarkable. So. We're already cruising out of time, but this is kind of what I wanted to share. I'd like your input on, you know, because this is kind of, I wanted some thoughts on what are your ideas. Has anyone had experience doing online course development? What are some of the things you have found? I want to call this one projects and portfolios. We don't do letter grades. We are a pass-fail program only, and that was, you know, big controversy at the start, that how will you get kids to do anything if they only get a pass? Well, you inspire them with learning. Oh. And what I realized, when we had a letter grade conversation with a student, they'd say, what do I need to do to get an A? Have any professors ever heard that? Doesn't that put a ceiling on their learning? I say, as soon as I give them an A, they stop. Like even our children, like my daughter comes home from school and she says, I have 103%. Think I can get a conversation of do more. Well, how'd you get it? Well, I turned in a bathroom pass and I got extra credit, you know, all this stuff. And it's like, okay, so you've capped their learning at an A. So now I say, pass, fail. You're going to get a pass if you just do stuff. You're going to get a pass. Now what do you want to do? How far can you take your game? How far can you go with robots? How many inspirational things can you discover? And it's amazing when you take off that shackle, what they can do with it. It's really kind of remarkable. And again, what kind of academic success? I mean, if I had a dream, it would be that we teach them programming in the history class. And they need to code games or websites or whatever all year on history topics as their projects. Or we teach them game design in science and they have to make games that teach science principles. I mean, that's doing, right? That's not just listening. That's anyway, so I could go on and on. Any thoughts? I'll stop there.
Good question from our digital participant.
Yes.
Yes. How does the State Office of Education view your transcripts, and how does that work with accreditation?
Oh, that is my day-to-day life.
She's a principal at a high school as well.
So. Yes. Oh, yeah? Which school? Oh, hi, Delana. That's a great question. She's actually on the State Charter School Board. And she knows as well as any that I've been up to the state office however many times to battle for the rights to have parents have the freedom and flexibility to choose. Now, how that works is we are required by USOE to give students access to curriculum that maps to Utah Core for every subject area. And they have full access to that. And we have certified teachers that they check in with once a week. And the accreditation is run through the school of partner, the partner school. So, but, I mean, she provides a great question. Is everybody happy with choice? No. Do USOE feel, do I continuously face the battle of every child needs to be standardized? Yes, I keep facing that battle. are we allowed by law to make reasonable accommodations for students? Yes. So although statute supports us, sometimes USOE says their policies need to limit choice. So it's a great question, and you know, we run a competing program. So Delana runs Mountain Heights Academy. That is a competing program to the MyTech High Provo eSchool model. So, but let me just say one more thing that I think Delana should be excited about. What we're seeing this year is probably for the first time, the number of first-time online students are joining the program, meaning that pie is getting bigger for all these schools and choice. Over the past few years, it's always been someone homeschooled, you know, always homeschooled. But we are seeing over the past couple years, people saying, I am looking for alternatives and I want to be able to see choice. And I'm thrilled with all the choice. Utah Virtual Academy, Mountain Heights Academy, eSchool, all these choices out there are better the more that we have for parents. So, hope that helps.
Piggybacking off of Delana's question, I'm wondering how accreditation and the powers that be view your pass-fail policy versus the standard letter grade. Has that been an issue at all that you've had to battle for?
No, there's actually lots of programs that just give pass-fail. Now, what it results in is a zero GPA. So parents have to decide if they want a GPA, then our program's not for them. I know Mountain Heights gives GPAs, right? So pick the path that you think's the right thing for your child. And
can I get a clarification?
Sure.
It's not a zero GPA, it's just that it doesn't enter into the GPA conversation, right? Like it doesn't drag the GPA down, it doesn't come in as a zero, it comes in as just not registered.
Fair enough. Well, they have no GPA if they're have been in our program the whole time.
I mean, if they're a la carte-ing, like adding a class.
Yeah, and we don't do the a la carte model.
Oh.
Choosing your courses through
the statewide online education program is different. We're not in that a la carte model. But yes, to clarify, it doesn't drag you down. Like if you come into the program with a 3 GPA from, you know, freshman, sophomore, and you're in our program junior, senior, it doesn't negatively affect it. It just has no impact on it.
Yeah.
So how do they apply for college?
Guess what? BYU doesn't require a GPA and doesn't require a high school diploma. Yeah.
Could
have
got into BYU.
We have a living testament right here. And just on the accreditation fact, 99% of the students in our program are non-diploma seeking. They have concluded that straight to college is a better path than going through all of the individual high school requirements for a diploma. So, and that's another thing that addresses accreditation. Accreditation is more interested in diploma seeking credit worthiness than non-diploma seeking.
Okay, we're going to take one more question.
Sorry.
And then we're going to end and go downstairs for soup kitchen. You're going to be able to.
That'd be great. You bet.
And there'll be lots of questions that you can ask there in the informal environment. Okay. So, Thomas.
So, do you keep track of pass and fails? So, if somebody like fails certain classes, and they just have to retake those classes to pass them?
Yeah, if they're interested in diploma seeking, yeah.
Okay.
Yep. I end with this slide too, just to spur your disruptions around education. Most likely to succeed, a Sundance Film Festival from this January around High Tech High in San Diego. Yes, we were inspired by their name. And Waiting for Superman, a couple of great documentaries on education reform that are worth your while if you're ready for a little bit of mental disruption.
Thank you for a very interesting session.
Jessica.
Sorry. I've been calling you Jen for like a week, I
think. Oh, it's okay. I didn't notice. It's all right now.
Jen, let's get that off the video camera. Jess.
It's
Okay. Jess, to take Matt down to the soup kitchen, let's let him be first. Our guests have oftentimes been off here and then haven't made it down. So if you can put your computer away, Jess will take Matt down and we'll ask questions down there at the soup kitchen. Thanks. So sorry.